emperor returned to the subject of Tilsit. There he had found the Tsar Alexander, an ideologist, full of ill-digested notions as to a situation, but actuated by excellent intentions, though he lacked experience. The emotions which estranged him from his wife had filled him with false ideas, even as to the need experienced by nations and great states for an heir to the dynasties which ruled over them. These notions had apparently carried him to the length of admitting advantages in an elective monarchy that placed merit on the throne, whereas hereditary succession commonly placed there an incapable, ill-trained fool. The Tsar Alexander felt no regret at his empresses having borne him no children. In general, he substituted all the virtues of good nature for those resulting from clear reason. He was a conscientious, private individual, not a prince. In his childishness, he saw only one responsibility the less, and a responsibility which, by his love of what was right, seemed to him a serious burden. He was apparently imbued with the idea that monarchs ought to govern for the people, and are instituted for the people. "That is also my maxim," added the emperor, dwelling on this principle as if he suspected me of doubting it, and wished to convince me. Instead of enjoying it, the Tsar appeared to me to be weary of sovereign power and a monarch's life, with its round of exacting duties for the man who regards the happiness of his people as a sacred trust held by him from Providence. Alexander is very religious. He is too liberal in his views and too democratic for his Russians. He will be the victim of this. That nation needs a strong hand. He would be more suited to the Parisians. He is just the sort of king the French would like. Gallant to women, flattering with men, even with those towards whom he ought to show his displeasure, for he knows better than anyone else how to hide his feelings. His fine bearing and extreme courtesy are very pleasing. Your good Frenchman loves flattery. He does not like my serious mien, and my firmness often proves irksome to him. Our conversations at Tilsit, his relations with you, and what passed at Erfurt have all combined to form the Tsar's opinions. He is clever. Nothing escapes him, and his memory serves him perfectly. Since that time, his own reflections and the course of events have furnished him with the experience that he previously lacked. He came to Erfurt quite a different man from what he appeared to be at Tilsit. I noticed at Erfurt that he was defiant and unspeakably obstinate. He wanted to treat me as between equals. As a matter of fact, circumstances were in his favor, and he took advantage of them. He might have obtained much more, but fortunately he only paid attention to the effect that would be produced in Russia by the hope of getting Wallachia and Moldavia. He did not insist upon the evacuation of the forts on the Oder and of part of Prussia. More fortunately still, Austria exhibited some ill humor and distrust. If the man she sent to Erfurt had been enabled to explain openly the views held by his court and to show some interest in Prussia, it would have made some impression on Alexander. I should have been placed in a very awkward situation, but even Prussia only sent an incapable fellow, and no one profited by the occasion. Anyhow, I was prepared for whatever might happen. I still had my troops at hand. The sacrifice in Spain was three quarters made. I should have crushed Austria before anyone could have stopped me. The Russians had not got over their defeat and were in no condition to make war. One might even have done me a service by forcing me to leave Spain, though it would have been disagreeable after the reverses we had met with there, and especially to have the English in the field. Threatened by Austria, I should have evacuated a great part of Prussia and retained only a fort on the Oder as security for the assessments. It is probable that such an arrangement would have caused many changes. We should not be here now. Other combinations would have been necessary in order to establish a buffer state. With Prussia liberated, restored, and reestablished, all political combinations would have been modified. Perhaps things would have been better and more advanced, for I should have been obliged to pay more attention to my war in Spain. I should have induced Russia to maintain the alliance and carry out the continental system against England. Thus it is that the most insignificant incidents can change the fate of the world, just as the mistakes of our enemies often serve them to better purpose than the talents of their generals and lead us into even greater errors ourselves. I was wrong in not remaining at Vitebsk to organize the country, or in not leaving Moscow a week after I entered the city. The reverses I have met with are due solely to that. I thought that I should be able to make peace, and that the Russians were anxious for it. I was deceived, and I deceived myself. Then Murray and the Abbe de Prat have not turned Poland to account. I expected to find it in arms, and it was asleep. Murray beguiled the Poles. The Archbishop discouraged them. I could not have made a worse choice or entrusted my affairs to a less capable man. I have been deceived by his cleverness. He knows how to argue and flatter, but he is incapable of showing action. The most insignificant of my secretaries would have done better. Men of his stamp belonging to the old regime are usually worth more than that. They are not liked in the army or the court. Yet look at Narbonne. Never did leader inspire more zeal in his men. Despite his age, he undergoes fatigues and privations like a young man. Yet he is upheld solely by a sense of honor. You men of the old army do not like these new adherents. In general, you do not like the emigres. Every time I admit one, whether to the court or to the army, I find grumbling and sulking. The bolder spirits take umbrage. It is not so long since they were even ready to rear like a horse, annoyed by the bad hands of a poor rider. I maintain that the opposition of which he spoke was well-founded so far as some people were concerned, for they but little merited the personal benevolence he showed towards them. Though so far as Monsieur Narbonne was concerned, he was universally liked and appreciated. This even applies to you, Caulaincourt, he said. Although you have risen from the ranks like the rest, though you are a soldier and your success is the fruit of your own labors, as is the case with all of my generals, yet your birth and your position as a nobleman arouse jealousy. I have had to uphold you, and on more than one occasion have been obliged to defend you. You are an object of envy. I have often received accusations against you. They tried to discredit you in my eyes after Moreau's trial, because you continued to see him, even after the days of the Army of the Rhine. It was but a pretext. Your real fault in the eyes of those zealous souls lies in the fact that you are of noble birth. I was not taken in. These prejudices are shared by many honest men. Having brought about your downfall, they would have attacked Duroc and Lauriston, the men who are so proud of bearing a title today, not so long ago were bitter against those who had one. Junot alone does not share this weakness. He considers himself more a marquis, more of a great nobleman than the Beauvau, the Lannes, the Bessières, the Lefebvre were eaten up with resentment. If I did the slightest thing for a man of noble birth, even if his claim to a title extended to no further than his father's purchase of it, they talked to me as though I were acting against my own interests, but I saw through them. Fortunately, I've never had a favorite, but if I had singled out any particular person, if I'd favored anyone of noble birth with my confidence, it would have made some men actually ill. By consolidating all interests, by mingling all classes and fortunes, time will exhaust these jealousies. The emperor spoke well of various persons, especially of Marshal Bessières, upon whose attachment he relied. He praised his integrity and his effective administration of the guard. I was obliged to take it from Lannes, he said. The itch to amass a fortune and the advice he took from some knaves who made him their dupe would have ruined him. Had I not removed him from that administration, no man, he repeated, has ever been or still is more attached to me than Lannes is at heart. More than once, He has given me proofs of this by exposing himself in perilous circumstances, but he loves me as a man loves his mistress and wants to manage me, or at least influence me, in order to obtain what he wants. Having been often refused, for his demands are in favor of schemers, he loses his temper, and being passionate by nature, he is then capable of anything. More than once in such moments, he has done me a wrong which might have proved serious to anyone else if he had to do with a sovereign of a different nature from mine, or one who held the human race in greater esteem.